Thank you so much. And thank you everybody for being here today to hear me talk about my book, Stranger in the Shogun City, A Japanese Woman and Her World. I know that tonight I am competing with the presidential debate, which I feel very bad about, or maybe I should feel good about it because maybe you'd rather be here than listening to what goes on there. In any case, as long as you are muted and I can't see you, I don't know whether you're watching the debate at the same time you're watching me, so please keep that in mind. So in any case, I'm going to share my screen and we can get going here. Let's see. View slideshow. There we go. So usually when I talk about this book, I give a kind of standard talk that just tells you what's in the book. And I would do that here, except that I know that this is an academic venue, and I feel like some of you might already have read the book. It's fine if you haven't. But just in case, I thought I'd give this talk a little bit of a different spin. So I'm going to introduce the book in the first part of the talk, but then I'm going to use the rest of the talk to think about how this book might help us consider the history of disaster, because we all seem to be living in an era of disaster right now. So by way of introduction to the book, I want to take you back in time first, not to the early 19th century, which is when this book begins, but instead to about the year 2009, when I was starting out as an assistant professor at Northwestern. And I was very excited because for the first time, I was assigned to teach about my favorite thing in the world, which is early modern Japan. And as I was getting ready to do this lecture course for undergraduates, I was looking around for things to assign and add to my syllabus. And in 2009, there really weren't a lot of materials about kind of mundane village life for me to assign to my students. So I was looking around for my own primary sources, trying to find things that I could translate myself and assign to my students. And I ended up on the website of the Niigata Prefectural Archives, which is someplace I had done some previous work for my first book. So I was on this website and I saw this Internetto Komonjo Koza, so an internet document reading course. And I clicked on it and started flipping through the pages or clicking through the pages. And essentially this was a course for ordinary people, probably people in the community in Niigata, that introduced the most interesting materials in the archive so that local people could see what was in the archive, then read a transcription of it and read an explanation, and they might be inspired to go to the archive and see these things for themselves. So I clicked on number 13, which was called, as you can see here, Ishigami Mura Tsuneno, Ie deshite Eda ni noboru. So Tsuneno from Ishigami Village leaves her house and goes to Edo. And there was this whole letter here from this woman named Tsuneno. Now at the time, I have to confess, I could not read this at all. I could read some of the characters, but I really couldn't make it out. But luckily for me, there was a transcription and also an explanation. And the explanation said a little bit about her life. And it also told me that there were hundreds more letters about her from her related to her in the archive. But it was really the content of this letter that grabbed me. So what it said was, and here's my translation of the beginning of it, to Mother Ninsenji from Tsuneno, confidential. I'm writing with spring greetings. As you know, I went to Kanda Minagawa Cho in Edo quite unexpectedly, and I ended up in so much trouble. And then this letter went on in the style that was shockingly vivid and almost contemporary. So she says that everything she eats in Edo is delicious. She recommends a certain kind of hair oil, which she's sending to her sister-in-law Sano. And I thought, you know, she sounds really a lot like me writing home email from my first trip to Tokyo in 1997 when I was a sophomore in college. So before I even knew the rest of Tsuneno's story, I fell in love. I went to Niigata as soon as I could to look at these documents. And I was standing in the archive. I pulled up all of Tsuneno's letters. There were dozens of them. And many of you know the way that Edo period letters are. They're kind of folded accordion style and they unfold and they can be really, really long. They can take up the width of an archive table. So I was standing there with my camera, kind of going down the pages, taking picture after picture after picture, hundreds of pictures. And even I had to kind of wonder what it was that I thought I was doing, because I could take all these pictures, but I could not read anything whatsoever. And I thought, not only am I wasting all of my time, I am also wasting my research money just standing in this archive taking pictures of things that I cannot read. And to make matters worse, not all of the things were letters. So some of them were letters, like the ones that I showed you. But they were all different. So the one in the background here is from one of her brothers. You can see it's in really blocky script. It's in kanji. This is Tsuneno's writing over here, which is actually a little bit different from her typical writing. Here is a envelope, which you can see is written in a completely different style. And it wasn't just letters, so it was other things like household diaries and records of expenses and inventories, so lists of things that Tsuneno had or that people bought. And this was all just completely overwhelming to me. So eventually, through a lot of struggle, character by character, I learned to read these documents using my trusty Kuzushiji dictionary. This is my dictionary for looking up characters in this style. And you can see that that's my research assistant there, my dog Bonus. And you can see that I completely destroyed that dictionary. Luckily, I have another one. So I keep it around all the time in case I need to read some Kuzushiji. But the other thing that I should mention here is that in addition to trying to read all of Tsuneno's letters and her brother's letters myself, after a while, I was able to hire research assistants in Japan who helped me with some of the transcriptions. And that was Murayama Kotaro and Yamagata Takashi. And I mention this because I think it's important to credit when you receive help from people, right? But also because research funding was absolutely critical. So to do this kind of work, you need the funding to be able to go to the archive, and then you also need the funding to get the kinds of help that you need to achieve your goals. So in any case, I learned to read these documents, but I really thought it was important to tell you about this process. Because you can look at the transcriptions and the translations of documents, and you can get an idea of what it is that they say. But unless you have an idea of what they look like, then you really have no sense of how these things were produced, why they're so difficult to read, or even the kind of material culture of sending letters. So one interesting thing about this archive is that the family kept drafts and copies of their outgoing correspondence. So not only did they save the letters that they received, they also saved drafts of the letters that they sent. And these are really interesting. So this is a draft letter that is on the back side of some sketches of samurai, which had been on the other side of the paper. So I just blew this up and I turned it around so that you can see the faint little figure of the samurai there. And it's also interesting to see the envelopes. So this is an envelope that's addressed to Tsuneno's mother, Hahasama from Tsuneno. That's the envelope from the first letter I showed you. And this is a letter with a very famous address, which I will get to later. So when you see these things, you can really think about the hands that folded the letters and the messengers and the express services that carried them across the mountains. So these are real material things that exist that you can go see and touch and read. In the letters and in these other archival materials, I found a story, which is what I relate in the book. So Stranger in the Shogun City tells the story of this woman Tsuneno's life. And it's also a window into Japanese society and culture in the first half of the 19th century. Tsuneno was born in 1804 to a temple family in a little village in Echigo called Ishigami. So here you can see my map of Japan. And over here is Echigo province, which is now Niigata. And here you have Kubiki County, which is her part of Echigo province. Echigo is actually huge. And then if you blow up Kubiki County, you can see Ishigami village right over here. So Tsuneno was born there in 1804, and then when she was only 12, she was married to another Buddhist priest all the way in Dewa province, up here, in the river town of Oishida. And Interestingly, this temple that she married into is still standing in Oishida in Yamagata Prefecture. And the original building of the temple has been rebuilt, but some of the structures remain, including the graveyard, which you can see here. Tsuneno lived here in Oishida for about 15 years, but that marriage ultimately collapsed and she was sent home once again to Echigo. After two more disastrous marriages in Echigo, one of which coincided with the temple famine, which I'll talk about in more detail today, her older brother planned to marry her off yet again. And Tsuneno decided that she would, in her words, rather die. So instead, she pawned her clothes and ran away to Edo, where she lived in a back alley tenement and found work as a maidservant. And there she married again. But interestingly, she married a man that she had known from home. So her fourth husband came from Kamoda Village, which if you blow this up, this is Ishigami Village. This is Kamoda Village. So he really was the boy next door, but she hadn't seen him in over 20 years when she had made it to Edo. She re-encountered him and he was working in Edo as a kind of masterless samurai. He was going around trying to get employment in various samurai households. And after that, she had a series of adventures that I relate in the book, but I'm not going to spoil them for you now because I'm going to tell you about them in the rest of the talk. So today, as I said, I want to talk about the disasters that are at the center of this book and also at the center of Tsuneno's life. They form a backdrop against which her story plays out. And I think that the effects of the famine and the political crisis are actually pretty clearly articulated in the book. But when people ask me what I would do differently if I had to do it over again, this is always what comes to mind. That is, I would have paid more attention to the social and the individual ramifications of disaster. So first, the temple famine. Tsuneno's second marriage took place in the summer of 1833 when she was 29 years old. And her new husband was a wealthy peasant in the mountain town of Oshima. So here's Kubiki County again. She goes from Ishigami to Oshima. But what you can't really see in this map, but you can see better on the topographical map, is that Ishigami is on the border of this broad plain that connects to Takata, and Oshima is further up in the mountains. In retrospect, marrying a peasant in Oshima in 1833 was an inauspicious combination, the year, the location, and the occupation, because the cold, wet summer of 1833 marked the beginning of the disastrous temple famine. And I write about this in the book. So I say that in the 1833, the year Tsuneno arrived in Oshima, even the best planning couldn't compensate for the weather. The rainy season had arrived on schedule with its light mists and heavy downpours, and the fields were flooded in the usual way. But the fog never lifted. Peasants waited in vain for the hot sunny weather that would encourage green shoots to emerge from the muddy water. Instead, it rained so hard that fragile young plants were submerged for days at a time. Late summer brought a freak snowstorm and an unprecedented early frost. When it was time to harvest, farmers were only able to salvage a third of the rice crop. Tsuneno's hungry neighbors, mountain dwellers who rarely saw the ocean, traveled to the seashore, waded into the surf, and tried to gather seaweed. One bad harvest could be endured, but the crisis continued the next year, since so many peasants had sold their seed rice to get through the winter. In Oshima, where Tsuneno lived, the harvest was only about 60% of what it should have been, and unbelievably, the crisis continued. So in 1835, the spring was freezing and the snow was late to melt, and the planting was delayed, so the harvest was terrible. By late spring in 1836, hungry farmers were so weak that even those who had seed rice and tools couldn't work, and the field stood empty. According to a village headman near Oshima, the harvest in the autumn of that year was the worst of all time. And here is what he writes about that terrible year. So as a result of these years upon years of catastrophes, the peak of the fatalities attributed to the temple famine came in the early spring of 1837. Across the Japanese archipelago, hundreds of thousands of people died. There were wild reports out of the Northeast, places like Akita Domain, rumors that half the peasants had died, that the survivors had resorted to cannibalism, and even more reliable accounts describe people reduced to eating their straw sandals and raincoats. One of the most eloquent visual testimonials to the damage of the famine came from the brush of Watanabe Kazan. Watanabe Kazan was and is very famous as a painter, but he was also a samurai in the service of Tahara Domain. And in his capacity as a samurai official, he was really interested in relief efforts. And he painted them. He actually painted relief efforts in the city of Kyoto near Sanjo Bridge. And this is a painting called Relief for Refugees in a Famine Year, and it shows you a lot of different scenes, a few of which I've pulled out here. If you're interested in this, you can search the title in the National Diet Library Digital Library, and you can see the whole thing. So it's fascinating because you can see them making these huge pots of rice for the relief kitchen. You can see the hungry people who look very emaciated and desperate crowding into the relief hut. You can see these weak and sick people, especially this mother here with her child beside her, and this samurai official over here who is at work attending to some of these people. And here again is another similar scene with emaciated children and a samurai official who is overseeing the relief efforts. The village headmen in Tsuneno's part of Edo also use their brushes to memorialize the crisis, but while Kazan, a samurai, was interested in the efforts of good governors, the village headmen tended to speak on behalf of their communities and lament the destruction. So I'll go back to the quote that I shared before. This is from a document called Kisai Tomegaki, which is from, again, Tsuneno's area of Echigo. And when you read between the lines, especially in 2020, you can see an indictment of the men in charge, the samurai administrators whose inability or unwillingness to organize relief had led to catastrophe in these mountain villages. This particular writer said explicitly that he'd written to memorialize the crisis and to ensure, as he put it, that nothing like this would ever happen again. He closed this document after his account of empty fields and starving peasants by urging his readers to tell their children and grandchildren what had transpired during the Tempo era and to remember to keep adequate stores of food in preparation for the next famine. In 2020, I thought of this village headman when I heard governors pleading with the federal government or talking about the lessons of the crisis. But since I was writing a book about an individual, I was interested in the ramifications of this disaster and how they played out in the life of someone who was, like I was in 2020, shielded from the worst effects of the crisis. Because as we know today, the burdens of these catastrophes are not equally shared. Since Tsuneno was married to a wealthy peasant, and she came from a family that had its own resources, she was not in danger of starving. In fact, one of the really remarkable things about the documentary record of the Tempo famine is that you can see it really clearly in the petitions of village headmen because they were responsible for their communities. But sometimes if you look at the documents of other wealthy peasants, you can really only catch glimpses of this catastrophe because they were not the people who suffered most. Still, at the edges of Tsuneno's story, you can see the impact of the famine. First, her family at home at Rinsenji Temple sold a stand of woods to neighbors in a neighboring village. And I share this document. I love this document because this is a document for the sale of a stand of woods. And they count the trees, every tree, and also how many, what kinds of trees there were. So there are 297 cedar trees and 310 trees in all. And this is one of the documents in the Rinsenji collection you can see around this time where the family is trying to raise money because they're in debt. They say in another letter that they are landlords and their peasants on their land can't pay, right? Because everybody is having trouble because of the famine. Then you can find a letter from Tsuneno's ex-husband, who was living still in Oishida. He was writing to her older brother. And I like this letter particularly because it's one of the only places you can really see spiritual language. Even though this is a temple family's correspondence, it doesn't come up very often. So Tsuneno's ex-husband describes how Oishida flooded and how the impacts of the flood and the famine meant that his parishioners' households had collapsed. And here again, you see a reference to cedar trees because he says that the hillsides around Oishida had become bare because people had cut down all the cedar trees. Now he doesn't make clear whether they've cut down cedar trees to use them as fuel or to sell them. But in any case, this detail is very striking. And he says, the suffering of ordinary people makes me think of the impermanence of this world. My only hope is to pray for salvation in the next life. There's one other piece of evidence about the famine that I've reconsidered in the months since my book went into production. And that is the death register from Ninsenji Temple. So here it is. This is the death register, the kakocho. And as many of you know, in the Edo period, Buddhist temples were charged with managing population records. So the famous Shumon Aratamecho that counted the population once a year. But in their religious capacity, they also kept death records, often including people's ages and posthumous names. So I never quite knew what to do with the Ninsenji death register because it wasn't coherent in a way, because I would know that there were a bunch of parishioners of the temple that I could track through other sources who never appeared in the death record. And this made me very curious about why people who should be there were never entered as dead. So I was reluctant to really rely on this source too much because I couldn't quite understand what was going on with it. But nevertheless, it was good for numbers. So you could see how many parishioners they'd registered as having died in a particular year. And it turns out that 1837, the worst mortality year of the famine, they recorded 10 names rather than the usual 4 or 5. Now, at the time that I put this in writing in the book, I mentioned it, but I didn't really think too much of it because 10 people seemed like maybe a lot in a year in one village, but it didn't seem like a mass death event. But now I think of it more in terms of the proportion. So compared to a regular year, twice as many people died. And when we think of that in the kind of context of our own pandemic, our death rate has not doubled, right? But it's even if it's only gone up, say 5%, that feels to us like a catastrophe because it is one. And so when I think about this now, and I think about the annual death rate in this village having doubled, I wish I had talked more about that more explicitly in the pages of the book. And finally, there's what happened to Tsuneno herself. She was married during the 4 years of the famine, and at the peak of the famine, in the worst year, she was divorced. I can't really conclusively link the fate of her marriage to the crisis, but I can imagine, and probably should have imagined more in the book, how a general atmosphere of failure and doom, how 4 years of futility could destroy a family. But I did get one thing right. I wrote about how stressful it must have been to cook for a family in an unfamiliar kitchen when rice was expensive and miso was impossible to get. In my own kitchen in the first month of the pandemic, dealing with strange shortages and limited shopping trips, I knew that bit of speculation was on point. And this brings up an interesting question, which I'm interested in discussing more later, which is, to what extent can historians use evidence from their own experience when we're writing about the past, and particularly the distant, faraway past? So please hold that, and we might be able to talk about it in the question and answer. So I don't know, in the end, whether the famine was the reason why Tsuneno ultimately ran away from Echigo. After yet another very short-lived marriage, her brother Giyu was trying to get her remarried for a fourth time, and Tsuneno wrote about this. She said, I refuse to marry some widower in some terrible place. But was the problem the widower, i.e. yet another marriage, as I basically assume it was in the book, or was the problem the terrible place? After living through so much devastation in the countryside, did she, like so many of us, feel the allure of starting over again in a different location? I do know that many of Tsuneno's contemporaries had the same idea, that the temple famine caused an exodus from the countryside, at least for those people who were still able to walk. And we can see this marked on the landscape at the places that were the edges of Edo. So for example, Tsuneno probably followed the Nakasendo into Edo, the Nakasendo highway, which runs between Edo and Kyoto, but it also branches off and merges with the Hokoku Kaido, which is the northern highway, which goes to Joetsu, which is where she's from. And you can see it labeled, it's this yellow path on this side of the big map of Edo. And then you can see it here running through the Hongo neighborhood of Edo. And the entrance to Edo from the Nakasendo is Itabashi Station. And at Itabashi Station, which is where all the refugees from the north would have come through, the shogunate established a relief kitchen, which must have been much like the relief kitchen in Kyoto depicted by Watanabe Kazan. There was also a true Pure Land Buddhist temple there, Jōrenji, so the same sect that Tsuneno was from, where the priest became very famous for going out into the streets of the station to collect the bodies of the dead. And it was said that he personally prayed for them and had them interred. And that grave is still there at Jōrenji in Itabashi in Tokyo. If the temple famine reverberated in Tsuneno's life and choices in ways that are a little bit difficult to see 200 years later, the effects of the political crisis that followed in the famine's wake were far more obvious. The shogunate made enormous efforts to spare Edo from the worst effects of the famine because they feared a repeat of the riots that had followed the last major famine in the 1780s, and that was the Tenmei famine. The relief kitchen in Itabashi, and like the relief kitchen in Kyoto, was part of that endeavor. And the shogunate also made sure that the capital was adequately provisioned, often at the expense of other areas of Japan. This strategy worked to quell riots in Edo, but the shogunate was shocked by a rebellion in the city of Osaka, led by the former shogunal official Oshio Heihachiro. This is the picture of Oshio Heihachiro that everybody always shows. It's the famous picture. What's funny about it is that he looks so serene, and this is absolutely not what he is known for. So he is known for this rebellion in the summer of 1837, where he raised banners saying, "Save the people," and assembled an army of 300 men. Together, they tried to wrest control of the city from the shogunate, convinced that they were delivering the judgment of heaven on a corrupt and indolent government. And so here too, you can see the indictment of bad government that you can only read obliquely through the lines in the petitions and documents of village headmen. But Oshio Heihachiro's rebellion lasted only 12 hours before it was put down viciously by the shogunate's forces, and thousands of buildings, a whole swath of the city of Osaka, burned. At the same time that the shogunate was grappling with the possibility of further domestic unrest, officials were also becoming worried about Western imperialism. They were already concerned about the incursions of Russians in the north, which were very important and I think kind of understudied, but they were also shocked by the Opium War. This is the first Opium War. This is an illustration from a book called Kaigai Shinwa. You can find this on John Dower's site, Visualizing Cultures. So the struggles of the Qing Empire alerted them to the terrifying military capacity of the British Navy and also the unexpected weakness of their mightiest neighbor in the region, which was Qing China. Meanwhile, Tokugawa Ienari, who was the wily retired shogun who was really running things in Edo, died unexpectedly. And here, this is interesting. I have his dates as 1773 to 1840. If you look him up, most places will tell you his dates are 1773 to 1841. This is because the shogunate actually kept his death quiet for 2 months while they were trying to figure out what to do about it. So he died at the end of the year and it was reported at the beginning of the next year. So this combination of troubles at home and threats from abroad, the Nayu Gaikan that we all learn about in Japanese history survey classes, was the impetus for a new phase of political reform. And the campaign's architect was this shogunal advisor named Mizuno Tadakuni, who set about trying to strengthen Japan's military defenses and shore up the shogunate's finances. But to him, crucially, reform was not only an administrative imperative, it was also a moral agenda, an insistence that the people of Japan should return to an idealized past in which commoners respected their rulers and manifested their submission through frugality and diligence. So Mizuno, zealous advocate for the shogun's interests, positioned himself as a moral arbiter. The irony was that Mizuno's personal behavior was notorious. People said that he drank like a whale and ate like a wild dog. They said that he collected gold and silver offerings as if he were a miraculous image of the Buddha, even though his conduct was not remotely Buddha-like. He never helped a man who couldn't pay, and he never went out for the night without waking up in a brothel. No one had a single good thing to say about him. People in Edo joked that even his hair was terrible. Yet he persisted with his campaign, which blamed the faulty morals of the population for what had been a catastrophic failure of government. The city magistrates started to impose limitations on the activities of Edo's people, many of which were extremely petty. So they said things like, dolls over 9 inches are prohibited. Children do not need to play with elaborate toys. They will only become accustomed to inappropriate luxuries. Women are not allowed to wear fine embroidery. Fireworks are forbidden. Expensive potted plants should not be sold. Men should not use umbrellas in the rain. The price of tofu is too high. Either that or the pieces are too small. Tofu should cost 8 copper coins per piece, and each block should be cut according to uniform specifications. Neighborhood guardhouses should clarify their policies about lending out items such as sandals and lanterns, and they should post clear lists of these rules on the walls. So these are all trivial things, and they give you a sense of why this was so enormously unpopular. But the major cultural struggles of the temple reforms were about publications, theaters, restaurants, the games played by the city's children, and interestingly, women's hairdressers. The city magistrates forbid women's hairdressers to ply their trade on the grounds that women paying to get their hair done was a disgraceful waste of money. They would have to make do with messy topknots that they put up themselves. Women who did not comply, who were caught with fashionably oiled and styled hair, were arrested on the street. Tsuneno didn't write about her hair, although she frequently asked her parents, her family to send her hairpins and complained that her unkempt appearance was embarrassing. For Tsuneno and her fourth husband, Hirosuke, the masterless samurai, the problem with their reforms was that they devastated the urban economy, and particularly the service economy. The problem wasn't just hairdressers. Restaurants closed, the theater district was temporarily closed and then relocated to an inconvenient place, and female musicians were arrested. Their instruments were hacked to pieces and set on fire in the magistrate's office. This was a catastrophe for poor people who relied on those businesses to make a living, and even the city magistrate realized that Edo's poorest people were bearing the brunt of the economic damage. In a letter home, Tsuneno related stories of her fellow migrants to Edo. A man named Isuke from a village near home was working as a clerk. He had not been able to find a place to stay, so he was moving around the city, imposing on his friends. A 70-year-old woman had come to the city to marry and found herself completely destitute. She had been working for a year and was practically naked. It was pitiful to see. A very fat woman named Hatsu, the mother of one of Tsuneno's acquaintances, had been coming to her house, eating their food, and demanding pocket money. She doesn't even apologize for the trouble, Tsuneno wrote. Meanwhile, Tsuneno knew people who were 70 gold pieces in debt. She could barely believe it. As for me, she wrote, I've only borrowed 1 gold piece and 2 coins from the pawn shop, and look how much I've suffered for it. The desperation Tsuneno witnessed stood out in contrast to the wealth she saw all around her, on a scale that had been unimaginable in Echigo. People in the countryside have no idea what Edo is like, what the mansions are like, she wrote. Yet even the poor were required to keep up appearances. She was working a temporary job as a maid servant, and it wasn't going well. I have 4 fellow servants, she wrote, and they never talk to me except to tell me that I'm doing something wrong. They all compete with one another and they're stubborn. Right now, I have all my clothes in pawn and I'm struggling, but I think that if I just manage to persevere for a little longer, it will probably get better. And then she added, it's not at all like the countryside. You can't just walk around looking terrible. One of the cruel ironies of the reforms, which is ostensibly meant to restrict conspicuous consumption, was that they made it impossible for struggling people to maintain a veneer of respectability. Even pawning clothes, which was Tsuneno's usual strategy when she was in economic distress, wasn't working as well as it had a few years earlier because the pawn shops were overstocked and the used clothing stores were overflowing and being driven out of business. No one could get a good price for clothes, in part because no one knew what kind of clothing would be acceptable to the enforcers working in the city magistrate's office who had been told to crack down on luxurious clothing. You can see in Tsuneno's letters how this stress affected her marriage. Her fourth husband, Hirosuke, was working in service to samurai households, and this was a job that could be unstable in the best of times because samurai would just let go of workers when they didn't need them anymore or when they couldn't pay. Hirosuke was totally unemployed, and Tsuneno complained that he wasn't even trying to find work. She says, if I have even one piece of clothes, he pawns it, and then he just eats his favorite things. And she also complains that when they don't have any money, he sleeps all day. And she said she's really, really sick of it. She's completely fed up. And then she writes, she goes on in another section of the letter, says sometimes his friend Masayoshi comes over and the two of them just talk about people and they never say anything good. And they even insulted Tsuneno's family, saying that priests were useless. Tsuneno was taking in piecework to make ends meet, and at one point she and Hirosuke were reduced to sharing a single robe. You'll be angry at me for saying it, she wrote to her brother, but Hirosuke is suffering too, and I feel sorry for him. Ultimately, Tsuneno decided that this situation was intolerable. She wanted a divorce. Hirosuke reluctantly complied, and eventually, after failing to make ends meet on her own, her brothers had to rescue her and get her an escort back home to Echigo. In the book, I think of Tsuneno's marriage in terms of the phrase I talked about earlier to describe the tensions leading to the temple reforms, troubles at home and threats from abroad. The point of this phrase, which comes from classical Chinese, is that both are a problem and they reinforce each other. In Tsuneno's marriage, there were obviously troubles at home in the dynamics between her and her husband, and the threat from outside was the collapse of the urban economy. I write about Tsuneno's return to Ishigami village in defeat. Tsuneno, too, had returned to a situation she found intolerable. There was time to wonder what had gone wrong. Was it a political catastrophe, a threat from outside that had destroyed her marriage? Or were the problems always there, like blight in the soil, waiting for the season to change? When she looked into the garden at Rinsenji, all she could see, all anyone could see, was snow. I think about that last sentence a lot for two reasons. First, because it's a good example of one of the issues that I faced in writing, which is how much to speculate or extrapolate from the evidence I had. In fact, to me, that one sentence is the most marginal sentence in the book. I wrote it and I took it out and I put it back and I took it out and I put it back again. Because the thing was, I didn't have any direct evidence that Tsuneno looked into the garden at Rinsenji and saw snow. On the other hand, temples had gardens or outdoor space, and it snowed in Echigo all the time. There's a reason it's called the snow country. And if you looked outside the window in winter, or outside in winter, you would see snow. If it hadn't snowed that winter, somebody would have been shocked and written it down. So in the end, I kept that sentence in. And I'm glad I did, because ultimately I feel like we are now in a time where all anyone can see is snow, or maybe in California, smoke. It's hard to figure out what the crisis is when it's all around us. Catastrophe is profoundly disorienting. And I think it's good to remember when you're writing history that your historical actors were a lot like us. They often had no idea what they were doing or what was coming next. It's only in hindsight that the snow melts or the smoke clears, and we can see the outlines of our problems clearly enough to tally all the damage and attribute the blame. Although, of course, it's clear to us, as it was during the temple famine, that failures of government are often fatal. After a few years, the immediate crisis of the temple reforms passed. Edo's restaurants and theaters came back, the women's hairdressers picked up their tools, the singing teachers found new instruments. But some people never recovered. The romance writer Tame Nagashunsui, who had been charged with obscenity and whose woodblocks were confiscated, was one of them. People said that he died of a broken heart. The painter Watanabe Kazan, whose paintings of the relief kitchen I showed you earlier, was another. In 1839, before the temple reforms officially started, he was caught up in a political purge and accused of conspiracy. He committed suicide in 1841. But Tsuneno was a survivor. She returned to Edo in 1846, remarried Hirosuke, and resumed her old life, the one she had so desperately wanted, in the city that she loved. And in fact, she and Hirosuke ended up living in the office of the very famous city magistrate, Tōyama Kagemoto, and this is their very famous address that her family then had to write to when they wrote to her in Edo. Tsuneno died in 1853 in Edo, just before Perry's ships came, and by then it was as if she had always belonged there. And that at least gives me some hope. There's one other thing that I wanted to show you before I end, and that is this picture of a vampire. So this is probably the last thing you expected to see, but I'm showing it to you for a reason. So today I was trying to write this talk and I was trying to finish my slides, but my kids are out of school. I have two. And I was trying to help my first grader with Zoom school, which he hates. And instead of going to Zoom school, he wanted to draw a vampire. And I was really busy. I wanted him to do his reading and his work, but he was refusing to do it. And he had this huge temper tantrum. So instead of actually finishing this talk, he and I got together and we drew this vampire. Now, I'm showing you this vampire because it's a metaphor for what has happened to so many women's and caregivers' academic careers in the age of the pandemic. But also, I think it's interesting to think about as a historical source, because if you were to say in 200 years, encounter this picture of a vampire in an archive, you would understand part of this story, which is a beloved child with a lot of art supplies in a safe place, drawing a vampire with the help of his mother. But if you didn't understand the actual context, you wouldn't know that even this little vampire, as cute as he is an artifact of disaster and the way that it can leave ripples in even the most protected and sheltered of lives. So thank you very much for coming to hear me tonight. And I'm happy to hear questions, to take questions, and also comments.